Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship at East Livingston Baptist Church. Let's begin with that beautiful hymn, Wonderful Words of Life. You'll find that on page 261 in your hymnal, and we'll sing all the verses as we begin our service this morning. Wonderful Words of Life, Nordine. Let's stand and join your voices in praising God this morning. Sing them over again to me, wonderful words of life. Let me more of their beauty see, wonderful words of life. Words of life and beauty, teach me faith and duty. Wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Christ the blessed one gives to all, wonderful words of life. Sinnerless to the loving call, wonderful words of life. Also let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we come into your house this morning, we do want to tune our ears and our hearts to hear those wonderful words of life that you have to speak to us this morning through your Holy Spirit and through your Holy Scripture. We thank you for a beautiful morning when we can gather here in this beautiful sanctuary. Because God, it is important and it's essential that we come before you, that we lift our praises to you, and that we open our heart and life to hear what it is that you have to say to us. So bless us with your presence as we come before you this morning. And now, Lord, we ask that you hear us as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us when he said, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Before you're seated, take just a moment to greet one another. We'll be right back.
Thank you. Let's find our way back to your seat now. All right, put your books on the floor. Take out a piece of paper. Number to 10. We have a quiz this morning. Remember that when the teacher would say, pop quiz. No, it's my pleasure to welcome you to our service here at East Livingston. And I wish you a good morning and pray God will be a blessing to you in the time we're here together this morning. We have a big morning because we have a reception a little later, so let me get right to it and remind you of some of the activities going on in our church life. We do have our regular meeting this Wednesday, our Bible study, and then on Saturday, I've been trying to remind the members of the advisory council, that's all of our church officers, we will be meeting from 9 to noon right here at the church Saturday morning, so make sure you get that in your phone, on your calendar, on any other electrical device that you use to keep track of your life, and join us at 9 o'clock on Saturday morning. But there's a picture of the fellowship hall. We've been telling you the good news from our finance committee that the loan that was taken out back in 2001 to finish paying the cost of that building was we completed paying it off about 2 months ago, and this morning is the celebration. So click that again if you would be so kind, and again. And there's the announcement that today is the reception to celebrate the completion of the loan for the building. The building includes a recreation room on the lower level, and it has been a blessing to the congregation for the last, 16 years. So it is a wonderful reception in the fellowship hall after the service is over. We invite everyone to join us. Light refreshments, it's not a luncheon, but you will find some delicious refreshments. And then we've got a few remarks about the importance of the building and the significance of passing this milestone. So we hope you can join us and help us to celebrate this milestone in the life of the congregation. So these are announcements that are going on. I decided I would show you a video that many of you have seen as part of our celebration this morning. It's a video that was put together by our son, Glenn Winters, to celebrate the 50th anniversary of the congregation. In 2012, we had a big banquet. It was wonderful, and we celebrated the 50th anniversary of the founding of East Livingston Baptist, and this video was created for that event. We showed it that night, and I've showed it a couple times here, so some of you have seen it, but I'm going to show it again so that you can see the church building without the fellowship hall. Many of you have been members of the congregation, and for you, the church includes the fellowship hall, the recreation room downstairs, restrooms on this level, a beautiful baptistry. That is what the church means to you. But when the church was built, none of that was there. And the pictures on here remind you that the church building was much smaller. So we're going to roll that. I'm going to help with the electronics over here. And you can take a look at East Livingston Baptist Church through the years.
him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy. Struck wonder at the mention of your name.
Uh-oh. What?
Why? Why did you do that?
All right, fine. I'm not going to make you sit and have me try to figure out what went
wrong there. Because that's really boring to watch somebody at the computer. But you got to see the congregation. When the building was built, there was no steeple. It was a cupola. And the end of the hallway on both this level and below was the end of the building. So when you drove by on Livingston Avenue, you just saw, you know, the side of the building. But I always like to look at this because I get to see people from... Mary, did you see a couple of your... and hair, you know, styles it. And all that. It's just fun to look back. The theme when we turned 50 was looking back and moving forward into God's future. So, sorry about the glitch. Have no clue why that happened. But you got to see a little bit of the building that we're celebrating today, the completion where we have a baptistry, a fellowship hall, recreation room. So, all right. Well, we're going to have our praise song. And we don't have to depend on a video for that today.
All right, Today's song is very familiar. Shout to the Lord. If you'll stand, we'll follow the word. Our ushers are ready, so let me invite them to come and wait upon us for this morning's offering time, where we bring our tithes and offerings in recognition of the blessings of God in our lives. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we sing our praises to you, as we testify that nothing compares to the promises that you have given to us, the promise of everlasting life with you. We come now to ask your blessing on these gifts. God, we come as stewards of the gifts that you have given to us. We thank you for that challenge and for the privilege we have of sharing with others that they might find the love and the freedom and the forgiveness and the salvation that we have found in you. So I pray your blessing on each gift and each one who gives this day, as together we continue to share the good news of your Son, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above these heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. And it is time for the junior church program to begin. And thank you, Ellen Brown, who is our leader this morning. Her helper is Steve Joseph. And our junior church program is for all children through age 4 up through the second grade. Just a reminder to any parents or grandparents of children that go to junior church, the policy of the Christian Aid Committee is that you pick those children up after the service. They don't just release them. The helpers wait until parents and grandparents come. So that's nothing new, but every once in a while, a reminder is good. So especially today with the reception, don't go to the reception. Go downstairs, retrieve your little one, and take them to the reception with you. They're going to want to have a piece of that cake, I can guarantee it. So. But anyway, yeah, when the service ends, you go down and you retrieve your young one. Well, while they're getting started with the junior church program, we go to our time of prayer. We do this each week as a chance to pause and quiet our hearts and turn to God. We give you the prayer list each week so that you can be praying not only on Sunday but throughout the week for one another as church family, as we lift one another up in prayer. So let's go to the Lord in our prayer this morning. Loving God, we do come into your presence, seeking your voice, speaking from our own heart to you, lifting our praises, worshiping you. And as we come to this prayer time, we do lift our praises. We acknowledge you as our God. You have created us. You have sustained us. You have given us your Son, that our sins might be forgiven, that we might live an abundant life with the promise of eternal life. We praise you for all of these things, God, that you have done in our life and that you are doing. You alone are worthy for us to raise our praise and adoration. And so we come with worshipful hearts to you, God, as we come to you and turn to you in prayer this morning. In our prayer, Lord, we want to ask for your forgiveness. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We do not come to this service, Lord, this morning because we do not sin. We come because we are sinners in need of forgiveness. And so we humbly ask that you forgive us of our sins, that you fill us with your Spirit that we might have the wisdom to know how to avoid sin. And God, as we do, we thank you for that grace that removes our guilt. Thank you for the mercy that you rain down upon us. We're so grateful, God, for that mercy, for that unending love. We thank you, Lord, for this opportunity of gathering together as part of the body of Christ. It's a sunny, beautiful morning, but Lord, it wouldn't matter what the weather was. The power comes in our heart, in our life, as we gather together and know that you are here in our midst. We thank you for that presence. We thank you for that power. We thank you for the love that we share with brothers and sisters within the body of Christ, that we can share with one another, that we can help each other carry burdens, that we can pray for one another, and that we can rejoice with one another in the celebrations of life. We're grateful, God, for all of these things, for they flow out of your heart of love and compassion and generosity. You are so good to us. And we thank you this morning, God, for those blessings and for your love and for your Son and for your Spirit. Lord, we lift up to you as well our prayers for those that we care about that have needs and burdens this morning. We pray for any who are in hospitals this morning. We pray for healing and for strength. We have loved ones in nursing homes and care facilities and unable to be out of their own home this morning. And though they're not here with us physically, we know, Lord, that you are with them through the presence of your Spirit. So we ask your blessing upon them wherever they might be this morning. Look down upon them. Let them know that we love them, just as you let them know of your love. We pray, God, for any who have come together this morning, any of us who gather for this service, who carry a burden in our heart and life. And you've told us, Lord, that you are aware of each of these burdens. We need your help, God, to live this life as you have called us to live. And so we reach out to you and we ask for your help. We ask for your comfort. We ask for your strength. We ask for your guidance. Shine your light upon our path that we would know which way to go. Give to us, Lord, the answers that we seek. Strengthen us when we are weak. Comfort us when we are sad. Lord, we come to you because we know you are the one that has what we need. We thank you, God, for that promise and for that reality in our life and in our church. We pray for our world this morning, our nation and our world. We live in a time where the news assails us of war and violence and turbulence and stress. And Lord, we look to you. We know you have the whole world in your hands. And help us, Lord, in our faith, to remain faithful to you and to remain strong in living out that faith in a world such as ours. Let your light shine in our life that we might be beacons of light in the darkness of this world. We pray for our leaders as they make difficult decisions and face difficult situations that affect us all. We pray for your wisdom and we pray for your guidance, O God, upon those who lead us. And here in our congregation, Lord, even as we celebrate this morning the reaching of an important milepost, we give you thanks for the ability to achieve what we can in ministry here at the East Livingston Baptist Church. For God, there's nothing we can do without you, but with you, there's nothing we cannot do. And so we rejoice in accomplishments, we rejoice in goals reached. And we ask that you continue to show us the next place we need to go. Energize us and bring to us that enthusiasm of the Spirit that we need to know that we are following your will for our lives and for our church. God, as we come together to learn from Holy Scripture, we pray that it would come alive in our heart this morning, that we would be edified, that our faith would grow, that our enthusiasm for living for you and sharing the gospel with others in word and deed will be renewed. For Lord, this is why we have come, to meet with you, that we might do your will. So Lord, I pray that you would hear all of the prayers that we lift to you this morning, those that we write down, those that we speak, and the quiet, unspoken prayers that we carry in our hearts. Hear us all, O God. This is our prayer this day. And then speak to our hearts as we look to you and we ask you, how is it that we can follow you more closely this day and every day? So God, receive our prayers as we offer our prayers with confidence and with thanksgiving. And as we pray, we do so as always in the name of the one who came and gave his life, that we might have abundant and everlasting life. For we pray in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, our scripture reading this morning is from the Old Testament. It's the last book of the Old Testament, the book of Malachi. And the text is from the last chapter of Malachi, chapter 4. The reading, as you see in the bulletin, Malachi 4, the first four verses, verse 1 through 4. So you can follow along if you'd like as I read our text for today, Malachi chapter 4, verses 1 through 4. Surely the day is coming, it will burn like a furnace. All the arrogant and every evildoer will be stubble, and that day that is coming will set them on fire, says the Lord Almighty. Not a root or a branch will be left to them. But for you who revere my name, the Sun of Righteousness will rise with healing in its wings. And you will go out and leap like calves released from the stall. Then you will trample down the wicked. They will be ashes under the soles of your feet on the day when I do these things, says the Lord Almighty. Remember the law of my servant Moses, the decrees and the laws I gave him at Horeb for all Israel. And may God bless to our heart the reading of this portion of Holy Scripture this morning. So, have you ever owned
something so valuable, so precious, that you worry that someone somehow might take it from you? It's not necessarily that common, but it does happen. I mean, maybe you have some precious jewelry, maybe it passed down through your family. Maybe you have a valuable collection. You know, it used to be stamps and coins, now it's comic books, things like that, baseball cards. Paintings, of course, a piece of art can be so valuable that you must protect it. Maybe you have something like that, or maybe you have had something like that, or maybe that just doesn't include you at all. So, what if I told you that we have something like that right here in our sanctuary? It's not in my pocket. No. Here's my wallet. That's not. That's not what it is. But there is something here. It's not the electronics up there in the booth. It's not gold. It is right in front of you. It is the Bible in the pews. It is the Bible that you brought with you this morning. It is our Bible. Throughout history, the Bible has been so valuable that it has been a threat to some who have wanted it banished or forbidden. The Bible has been locked up to protect it. No, you can't have it. You can't read it. People have literally given their lives in order that the words and the message of the Bible could be made available to us to be read and to be taught. The Bible is very, very valuable. It is our instruction book on how to live the Christian life. So when I was a boy, I think I was probably 7 years old, 7, 8 in there. Loved to ride my bicycle around my hometown. In those days, it didn't matter if you wanted to ride your bike around hometown. Everybody knew me anyway. So if I got in any trouble, my mom was going to know. So I loved riding my bike around. And there was a day where the air was a little short. The tire was going a little flat. And I needed to put some air. I pulled into the Shell station that was in downtown and wanted to put some air in my tire. Now, the air was free back then. You didn't have to have quarters or anything. Now, air, you know, it's expensive, you know. But I pulled in, I got the pump and attached it to the tire, and I started to fill up the tire. Now, the bike tire had a little insert inside of it. I don't think that's how it is nowadays, but it's almost like a balloon that's inside the tire. And I was young, very young. I didn't know how careful I needed to be in filling up, so you don't put too much air in that thing. I didn't know that. Warren knew that, but my grandpa knew that, but I was by myself, so I kept putting the air in, and bam, that thing exploded. The boom was so loud, it made my ears ring. Didn't hurt me in any other way, but the ringing was definitely there, and to this day, I still have some of that ringing. It's called, I learned, tinnitus. And as I stand before you right now, I can hear a little bit of ringing. So it's something I've lived with my entire life. So several years ago, my loving wife, Linda, bought me a fancy and wonderful machine that helps mask the ringing at night if you have tinnitus and you're trying to go to sleep. Because there are times when if you're in a very quiet room, like a bedroom at night, the ringing can get loud and it can interrupt the going to sleep. So they make these wonderful little machines, very high tech. The cool thing about this is that it works, this little machine. It has a clock in it. You can even use it like an alarm clock. It's very cool. I really like it. But there's one catch. If the electricity goes out for any reason, if this gizmo gets unplugged for any reason, it has to be reset. The electricity goes off, it gets unplugged, plug it back in or the power comes back on, and the settings are all off. The lights come on. Everything that I'd put into it before is all gone. And so in order for me to use it properly, yeah, I hear that phone. It's okay. I'm going to keep going. I have to reset it. Now, I mentioned to you it was very high tech. So it's not all that easy to reset. And the other day, you know, these storms we had, Dana said he was glad we didn't have to come to church and paddle boats this morning. It was quite a storm this week. And during that storm, the electricity at our house blinked off and then came back on. So when it was time to go to bed, that machine needed reset like it always does. So I started fiddling with it, as I always do. And I was doing okay, but I couldn't get the light to go out. It has a light on it, and I need that light to go out so it doesn't keep me awake at night. I've reset that thing before, so of course I figure, I know how to do it. But I'm over there fiddling and I'm fiddling, and the light is not going out. Now, you know what the problem is, right? The women know. I'm a man. I'm going to figure it out on my own. I know how to work this machine. I've done it before. I do not need to look at the instructions. It's the last thing men do. Right, Craig? Yeah. That's the last thing we're going to do. We can figure it out. Now, I have a loving wife, so she doesn't tease me too much, because she could easily say, honey, why don't you look at the instructions now? Thank you, Lenny, for not always saying that. Yeah. But she knows that that's what has to happen. So I finally said on myself, guess I'm going to have to get the instruction booklet out. So I found the booklet, and it was very simple. You just push the sleep enhancement button and hold it in, then the light goes out. Which I did, and it did, and then I slept just fine. Please see instructions. Many times with these gizmos we have, it says it right on there, please see instructions. Now that's the title of my message this morning, because I think it's the thrust of our text this morning from Malachi 4. Now, I already mentioned Malachi, and you probably already know. It's the last book of the Old Testament. It's a book of prophetic oracle. We call it a post-exilic book, which means the people of God, the nation of Israel, have already been in exile and in captivity in Babylon, and they've been released and they're back from that exile. And now the prophet Malachi is writing. It's about 430 BC, about 400 years before the birth of Jesus. And Malachi's purpose in writing was to ensure that God's people had their hearts right, that they were keeping God first in their lives. And to do this, Malachi tells them in verse 4 that we just read, Remember the law of my servant Moses. Remember the decrees and the laws that I gave him at Horeb for all Israel. Now, if Horeb sounds a little funny in your ear, it's the general name for the whole mountain range, of which Mount Sinai was one of the summits. This is a way of talking about Sinai, where God gave Moses the Ten Commandments. And Malachi goes even further, and he's also referencing the Deuteronomic law, which translates for us today as a way of talking about the Word of God, the Bible. So Malachi is talking to us about the Bible. And as the Old Testament period is winding down, and the appearance of Jesus Christ, sorry about that. Every time I do a or a, you know, sibilant, I'm popping this out. If I move it down a little, I won't do that. Let's try that. Here's what Malachi is doing. He's saying, remember the Word of God, right? He's saying, remember the Scriptures. He's saying, do not forsake the truth and the teaching of the Bible. Or you could put it in another way. Please see instructions. Because of the importance of knowing the Bible, we focus a lot on the Bible here in our church family. That's why we do that. It's part of what we need to stay strong spiritually. When I preach to you, my message comes from the Bible. It's not just, you know, something I saw on TV or whatever. Sunday mornings, we come to Sunday school to discuss the Bible and how it impacts our life. Wednesday night, we come together for Bible study. We make the daily bread booklet available out in the hallway to you as a guide if you want to use it to read your Bible on a daily basis. We're saying, please see instructions. Please read and study and live by what you learn in the Bible. These are the wonderful words of life we were singing about. So when I was a student at Ashland College, back in my college days, studying music, preparing for the seminary, I was struck by the ministry of a man who went by the name Brother Andrew. Some of you have seen his writings. Andrew was from the Netherlands. And as he was preparing for mission work, and this was a way back, his preparation was back in the 50s when I was born. But as he was preparing for his mission work, he attended a youth rally in Poland, and it was sponsored by the Communist Party. And this was during those Cold War years of the Soviet Union. And at that rally, he discovered that Bibles were being banned in the countries behind the Iron Curtain under Soviet control. And he writes about how his heart was touched with passion from that moment on for sharing the scriptures, for getting the Bible to people who were not allowed to have it. It was illegal. And so he began a ministry of smuggling Bibles into these countries, carrying God's word to the faithful, preaching to the spiritually isolated. And he's written a book called God's Smuggler. And in that book, he says this: I would pray when I would get ready to cross the border into the communist held country. And he said, my prayer would go like this: Lord, in my luggage, I have scripture that I want to take to your children across this border. When you were on earth, you made blind eyes see. Now, Lord, I pray you make seeing eyes blind. Do not let the guard see these things that I'm taking, things that you do not want them to see. And he would say, amen. And after his prayer, he would drive up to the border crossing. And he said, time after time, the guards would wave his car through. Even though his car was filled with hidden Bibles, like he would cross the Yugoslav border with these Bibles. And his ministry went on for years, giving Christians in communist countries access to the Word of God, the Bible that was forbidden to them at that time. The Bible is very valuable. So what about you? Do you heed the word of Malachi as you follow the Lord Jesus Christ today? Do you remember God's word? Do you read? Do you study? Do you live by the words of the Bible? It's a challenge for all of us. And if you do, awesome! Keep it up! This is how we find forgiveness and strength, how we find comfort and challenge in our daily walk with the Lord. Proverbs 3:13 tells us we are blessed when we seek wisdom from the Lord. For then we gain understanding, for God's word is more precious than silver and gold, and nothing we desire can compare to the word of the Lord. So as a young person, I was so inspired in my own life by the passion and the courage of someone like Brother Andrew that I became a Bible smuggler myself. I told some of you the story. I haven't written a book or anything like Andrew, but I did become a Bible smuggler. It happened when our college choir was planning to go and tour in Europe in the early 70s. And before we left for that tour, I met with some of the other choir members who I knew were on fire for the Lord, and we talked about smuggling some German language Bibles into Czechoslovakia. It's now called the Czech Republic. It's where Gloria Ginn is serving this morning as a missionary. It's where our own Dave and Ellen Brown served as missionaries. And we were going into that country in the days of the Soviet Union. So around a dozen students agreed to join together in this effort. So we prayed, much like Brother Andrew did. And we asked God to help us be successful in taking God's word to those where it was forbidden. It was such an amazing experience for me. It's been over 40 years ago. It still gets me all emotional when I think about it, when I talk about it, because it was so powerful to see God help us do what we did. We bought German language Bibles when we were in Munich, similar to this one that I've kept all those years. We put these Bibles in our suitcases, and then we took them across the border. And even though the tour bus was searched, that was always done in those days, none of the Bibles that we were carrying, there were 13 of us, none of those Bibles were found. And so we took them on into Prague. We left the Bibles in public places where they could be found, and we simply prayed, Lord, guide someone to this Bible who needs it. None of us were caught. None of us got in any trouble. And in addition, while we were in Prague, we were able to sing inside St. Vitus Cathedral, the huge, beautiful cathedral in town. Even though the concert we had was canceled, we were going to sing about Jesus Christ. And they canceled our concert. But our director brought us together inside St. Vitus while we were on the tour. On the left you'll see, and on the right you'll see. And he just brought us together quietly. And we sang two songs to the glory of God. People stopped and listened. Hebrews 4, verse 12 says, for the word of God is alive and active. So when we think about the power of the word of God, it has literally changed the world. It has changed history. It changed me. It changes you. And as we read Malachi's reminder to not set aside the word of God, I hope we can all realize what a treasure we have in God's word and what a privilege it is for us to be able to own our Bibles, to be able to read them, to be able to study them. So be encouraged today. Be inspired by the words of the prophet who reminds us to remember to learn and to study and to live by the mighty words of the Bible. We have an instruction book. So whether we're men or women or boys or girls, it doesn't matter. We need to use it. We need to apply it so that it can guide and direct our lives to the glory of God. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the words of Malachi as he reminds us of the power of your word. Lord, it brings us wonderful words of life, words of forgiveness, words of compassion, words of mercy, words of hope, words of promise, words of salvation and words of everlasting life. These words, God, fill us with the faith that we need to follow you. And so we're so grateful this morning for the word that you have given to us. Continue to inspire us to make use of what we have and never to put it aside and take it for granted, but always to be blessed and strengthened in our walk with you as we pay attention to what you have given to us, the roadmap that you have given. And we thank you for your precious word this morning as we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So our closing hymn is a hymn that many people say, oh, that's one of my favorites. Hymn number 187. A hymn of being in the presence of God. A hymn of seeking the Lord in the garden. Only has three verses, so we're going to sing all three verses. If you're here this morning and you've never opened your heart and life to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, we make that our prayer this morning, that you would open your heart, receive this gift that God has for us through faith, the gift of eternal life, the gift of salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord. And as you open your heart to Him this morning, share that with us by joining me here at the front as we sing. But the hymn is a hymn of testimony, a hymn of commitment. We want to be in the presence of God, whether it's in the garden or anywhere that we are. So we'll sing all three verses. Norma, let's stand as we sing. I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the rose, and the voice I hear, the Son of God discloses, and He walks with me, and He talks with me, and He tells. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever. He speaks, and the sound of His voice is so sweet, the birds hush their singing, and the melody that He gave to me. So we invite you to join us in the fellowship hall for our reception at this point. I'm going to offer a prayer of thanksgiving for the food that is in the fellowship hall and invite you to go to and begin the line and get your food and go ahead and find a seat. Once everyone's been through the line, then we'll have some remarks about our celebration today. But let me ask God's blessing on the food that we'll have at the reception that we'll be dismissed to go. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for meeting with us this morning. You've told us when we come into your house, when we come together in your name, that you are here in our midst. And we have felt your presence this day, and we're so grateful. We thank you for the words of the Bible that lead us and that guide us and that empower us, that answer our questions and that propel us into the future that you have called us. And now, Lord, as we move to a celebration of a milestone in the life of the congregation, we give you thanks for the food that has been provided for us. We ask your blessing upon it as we thank you for your provision and your blessing. Bless our time around the table as we celebrate serving you together in the ministry of the East Livingston Baptist Church. And so, God, go with us through the power of your Spirit. Enable us to be your servants this week. Our service ends here. Our service begins as we leave this place. And we give you the thanks. We give you the praise. In Jesus' name, amen.